Okay, I think we can get started. So a quick introduction of myself, Mark Thompson. I'm the Secretary General of the Association for the Prevention of Torture, which is a Geneva-based non-governmental organization working with governments and other national actors to effectively prevent torture and ill treatment. Important timing for us because we've just brought out a study where independent researchers have proved that there are effective measures to prevent torture and ill treatment, and some of you participated in the book launch earlier this week. We're fortunate to have the researchers with us. And one of the conclusions of that research was that ensuring effective safeguards in the early hours of detention is one of the most effective ways to prevent abuse. And of course, that is the subject of today's meeting, where we're looking in detail to the specific proposal of Juan Mendez to have a protocol on interrogations and to shift the focus to investigative interviewing. And to today we have the advantage of having experts who can talk to you about their experiences of this far more sensible way of going about policing. We have an array of speakers. We also have a message from Shane O'Mara, and I think we'll be starting with that after Ambassador Peterson's welcoming remarks, and then we'll go to the panel of speakers. So without any further ado, I will now hand the floor over to Ambassador Peterson from the permanent mission of Denmark, the UN, here in New York. Ambassador.
Thank you very much, Mark. Also, I'd like to welcome all of you to this very important seminar. We're very happy to be co-hosting and together with good partners in the fight against torture that Denmark has been quite involved in for some years now, and we're definitely going to continue also, I can assure you. But I think also this is a special week in a way, I would like just to lead off by saying very shortly that a big thanks to Professor Mendez, who is now ending his term after 6 years, working very hard. I think there's so much respect for that work that you have done here, and it has brought so much, been so important. So I'm also very encouraged that you, as you told me the other day, definitely is not retiring from the course as such, and still will be providing inputs. I think that's highly appreciated from all of us. Thank you for that. This seminar is, of course, kind of the lead off is also from the research, but also from your last thematic report, in which you state that there is a growing momentum surrounding the issues of investigation, questioning, and custody practices at the international, regional, and national level, and that this momentum is highly relevant to torture prevention. We definitely agree with Professor Mendez on that assessment. At the 31st session of the Human Rights Council in March this year, Denmark presented, with the assistance of the professor, a resolution focusing on torture prevention in the early stages of police custody and pre-trial detention. Among others, the resolution actually urges states to take a number of safeguards into consideration when reviewing their rules on interrogation, which we think was a very good result. The resolution also requests OHCHR to convene a seminar in 2017 on safeguards to prevent torture and ill treatment during police custody and pre-trial detention. And we hope that this side event today and hopefully a number of other good efforts, and then also the seminar in 2017 can keep the momentum going on the topic of your very well-documented report, a universal investigation protocol. So once again, thanks a lot for coming. It's a pleasure for us to be part of this side event, and we look forward to the discussion. Thank you.
Thank you, Ambassador. I hope you've all had a chance to see Juan's report. And if not, Juan, hopefully you will give that introduction, which will encourage everybody to read that. I think it's an excellent report. And I was just talking to Juan now about how the report's been put together. And it's clearly a contribution from a variety of sources, which I find very reassuring, because there's a coming together of many various actors working in this field who all feel that this is really a very relevant and timely topic and challenge for us to take on. So Juan, you now have the floor.
Thank you, Mark. And let me take the opportunity to thank Mark and the APT for all the support during my 6 years. The same with the mission of Denmark and the Danish government generally. I've been very fortunate to enjoy very steadfast support from many different sources. And this latest example, this my very last thematic report, is another example of that. We were fortunate to be able to bring together a number of experts to a meeting before we prepared this report. And it not only allowed me to avoid many mistakes that I would have made otherwise, but also I think the quality of the report shows that there is a very rich experience out there that needs to be shared, that needs to be disseminated better. My report, as you know, basically advocates for a new standard of interviewing in the context of criminal investigations. The format that standard may take, I called it a protocol because it seems to me that we're not saying protocol in the sense of international law. It's not a treaty that we're looking for. What we're looking for is a set of guidelines that go step by step in the different stages of a criminal investigation, and that particularly focuses on the interview process. And I learned in this last few months that for the most part, criminal investigations are driven by the need to obtain confessions. And there is another model. And there's another model that is not theoretical, that is not philosophical, that it is practical. And it's a model based on rapport with the person being interviewed, and particularly based in two cardinal principles of international human rights law. One is the presumption of innocence, and the other one is the prohibition, the absolute prohibition on any form of torture or cruel, inhuman, and degrading treatment or punishment. And because the prohibition affects not only physical mistreatment but also mental mistreatment, it follows that all forms of coercion of one form or another should be banned from the investigative and interviewing process. And it's important that the rapport-based model, to distinguish it from the confession-driven model, is in place in several countries, and it's showing very good results, because what we need to do in order to change the culture of many criminal investigators, investigative units around the world, is to persuade that this process gets better results. It gets better results because it doesn't violate the human dignity of anybody. And that's a first point. But it also gets better results because it's driven towards the truth, not towards a confession, but to the establishing the exact happenings that are relevant to the criminal investigation, and that can result from people confessing or from making statements against interest, but it also has to come from a variety of forms of corroboration of what people have to say in the course of criminal investigation. But it also works because it's proven that the countries that use the rapport-based interviewing model just happen to be places where the crime rate is much lower. And it's not, I can almost hear the argument, yes, that's because they can afford it. They don't have a very high crime rate, so they can afford not to torture people. But I think it stands to reason that if you have efficient criminal investigations and you have the cooperation of the society because you respect everybody's rights, you also get better results. And I don't think it can be said that it is a coincidence that countries that have a low crime rate are also countries that have a process of criminal investigation that respects human dignity in every stage of the process. Now, that's why I believe that we are due for a document along the lines of the very useful soft law instruments that over the decades the United Nations and international law more generally have used to elaborate and detail the way in which fundamental human rights standards should be incorporated into daily practice. Because obviously the prohibition on torture is clear, but what to do in the criminal investigation cannot be incorporated into the Convention Against Torture in more general terms, except of course for the exclusionary rule and the obligation to investigate, prosecute, and punish torture. But we need a more detailed and more forward-looking and practical set of standards. Just like we had for the prohibition on cruel, inhuman, and degrading treatment, the standard minimum rules on the treatment of prisoners, now the Nelson Mandela rules, just like we have in the case of investigation, scientific investigation and detection of torture, we have the Istanbul Protocol, just like we have for extrajudicial executions, the Minnesota Protocol, now recently updated. We need a document that establishes the gold standard for how serious criminal investigations and particularly interview processes in criminal investigations should be conducted. And even if we don't get universal acceptance early on, it is a standard that will allow us to change the culture of investigating agencies around the world. And it also, at the very minimum for us practicing in the human rights world, it's a standard that allows us to say, this is what you're doing right and this is what you're doing wrong. That's a usefulness of soft law documents of this sort. Now, what exactly it should be called, I called it a protocol for the reasons I mentioned, but it could be guidelines. It could be, what I think it's important to do, however, is to ensure credibility and purchase by all countries around the world early on. Rather than, of course, we need to have a very good document, but we also need to have a document that people have a sense of purchase of it, that they participate in its elaboration, that they look forward to enriching it with their own experiences. And finally, I want to say that this was serendipitous, but the report by APT, written by Richard Carver and Lisa Handley, that just came out, reinforces the need for this. I mean, it does say, first, it shows that the preventive norms that exist already in international law do work, but also that they need to be strengthened, that they need to be reinforced. And it says very specifically that torture seems to happen more in those cases where the safeguards in the criminal investigation process against torture break down. And if that's true, then we have to work there, among other things, of course. But if we now we have my report, which is a contribution towards the idea of generating a document of this sort, but now backed up by a very thorough and very persuasive research conducted by APT that demonstrates the need to come up with something like this. And I want to finish by thanking the experts that joined us in my expert meeting before we wrote my thematic report, and some of whom are here today, for giving us their wisdom, but also for being ready to continue to participate in this endeavor, shown by the very fact that they traveled from long distances to be here today. And so thank you very much, and I look forward to hearing more from the other participants.
Okay, thank you very much. Do we take Shane O'Mara now, or should we wait a little bit longer?
Maybe after.
Okay, fine. All right, so Juan, you were referring to the experiences of others, and we're very lucky to have today with us today Dr. Asbjørn Røslo, who's from the Norwegian Center for Human Rights. He's a Norwegian policeman who's currently on leave from the police. Norway's a country which has gone through a process of reviewing and reforming its police procedures. And I would therefore like to ask Asbjørn to talk us through why Norway chose to reform, and what's been the process, and what are the results, and is it something that police embraced initially, or is it something that now that you've gone through the process, would police revert to the previous ways of doing things? And it'd be very interesting to hear from your very practical perspective, how Norway has gone through that process. So, Asbjørn, you have the floor.
Well, thank you, Mark, and thank you, Mendes, for providing us with the opportunity to present the concept of investigative interviewing here at the United Nations. Now, as detectives, colleagues of mine around the world, I was taught to believe that once we got a suspect, it was my job to get him to confess. But 30 years of scientific research has told us that there is a better way of investigating crimes. There is an alternative that will provide the police with more information, more accurate information, and more reliable information. Now, the turnaround operation from interrogations to investigative interviewing requires a change of mindset. We have to teach our detectives to think differently. We have to provide them with knowledge and methodology that stimulates them to generate and actively test alternative hypotheses, not pursuing information confirming their belief of guilt. Now, we truly believe, based on sound theory and experience, 15 years of experience, that if the United Nations will follow the directions that Mendes has drawn up in his excellent report, we can actually operationalize the presumption of innocence. Now, torture is a fundamental and blunt breach of the presumption of innocence. Manipulation and other psychological coercive means, interrogation techniques designed to get the suspect to confess, are or may seem not as brutal as physical torture, but nevertheless, they are only different means to the same end, to get the suspect to confess. Such techniques does not require a change of mindset from torture. In fact, such techniques only feeds on and creates tunnel vision and feeds the seeds of torture. Now, if we want to change, we have to change the mindset, and we have to provide an alternative. If we take away a tool from a practitioner, we have to give him or her a new tool that they find applicable. And we believe, through investigative interviewing, that we can actually operationalize the presumption of innocence and prevent torture. Now, before I talk to you about investigative interviewing and some of the models and theories underpinning it, I would like to start by telling you a story. And this story is a very sad story. It started on the 22nd of July 2011 in Oslo, Norway. Our city was turned into a war zone. Unfortunately, it did not stop with the bomb. Anders Behring Breivik continued his spree killing and drove to the island of Utøya, dressed as a police officer, and with two guns. He entered the island that was full of children and teenagers gathered at a summer camp. And his mission was to kill as many as possible. And we were not able to arrest him before he had killed 68 children and teenagers. Now, this picture is taken of Breivik right after the apprehension. And you may think, and some people think, that this was an easy task for the Norwegian police. Norway was challenged. And we as police officers were challenged. 10 minutes into the first interview, Breivik threatened us and provided us with a ticking bomb scenario. He said that what you've seen here today is just the beginning. This is not the operation. This is only firecrackers of what is coming. Cell 2 and 3 are activating anytime. And we had to take him serious. Our city was burning, and there were children and teenagers laying all over us. Now, if I were to send you a postcard from Norway in shock the following day, I would probably send you this picture. This is our Prime Minister, Stoltenberg, now the Chief of NATO, hugging one of the survivors. This is our Minister of Justice. And Norway, on this day, the very following day, issued a statement to the world and to our people. The government said that Norway tomorrow will be recognizable. Nobody can take away from us our values or our democracy. That was the response from the Norwegian government. And this very day, I was asked to come into headquarters and lead the interviews of Breivik, to design the team that we're going to interview him. And this was a message from the Norwegian government to me, that stick to your values. Don't let him win. Now, when we talk about investigative interviewing, we have to then ask ourselves, what are our values? Of course, we have our domestic law. We would have more detailed guidelines, domestic guidelines. We would have guidelines from our state prosecutor, general prosecutor. We'd have Supreme Court rulings. And of course, we would have various human rights conventions that says something about the values that underpins how we should proceed in this situation. And we have our training program that we developed in the early years of 2000. These were our values. And this is what the Norwegian government told me and told us that we should stick to. The training program in Norway, which we call CREATIVE, is investigative interviewing. This is the third version of it. We have revised it constantly, and we are currently revising it again. And it's based on 16 theoretical PowerPoint lectures. But I want you to know that our training program and our ideology is based on the British turnaround operation 10 years earlier, the peace process, the development of investigative interviewing techniques. But we've had the advantage of learning and taking all the knowledge and the good experience, but also what we can progress and develop further. So the training program, as I said, consists of practical and theoretical lectures. We teach our colleagues the importance of planning and preparation. This is the peace model, and we've emphasized the need for a free account, that the suspect and witness and victims are actually provided with an opportunity to provide their account after the rapport building. We also have tested this model, this thinking, out in various countries in cooperation with the Norwegian Police National Police College and the Norwegian Center for Human Rights. Through the Norwegian human rights dialogues with Vietnam and Indonesia. We have provided them with this model, and they wanted more. Now, for eight years, we have been training in Indonesia. This was the Indonesian version. Investigative interviewing here, being taught in Jakarta. This is the Vietnamese version, They wanted us to come back and teach them more about this. And they are changing their curriculum towards investigative interviewing. Now it's a far, far road ahead before these thoughts are actually implemented in all offices around the world. But what I can tell you is that it was very hard to get into this police academy in the first years. Now we are invited in and we have free access and we talk to the teachers and we are developing and assisting them of developing their own lectures in their capacity. Now, of course, investigative interviewing is a big field because it has become a science with a lot of issues. And I cannot go into the details here with you, even though I wanted to do that. But I wanted to emphasize that back in 2002, the European, the Council of Europe, through the CPT, they issued a standard for how the European police should interview their suspects. They don't say very much, but if you know the tricks of the trade, you see that they say a lot. Number one, they say that the questioning of a criminal suspect is a special task which calls for training, if it is to be performed in a professional manner. We need to train and teach our officers. And then they say that the precise aim of such questioning must be crystal clear, and that is to gather accurate and reliable information. And they could have said stop and a period there, but they don't. It's a comma. And then they say the aim is not to obtain a confession from someone already presumed in the eyes of the interviewing officer to be guilty. Now this is the direction that Mendes has chosen to forward in his report. And of course we teach our colleagues the necessity of thorough planning. We talk about how the memory works, how the human memory works. We talk about the science behind memory-enhancing techniques, cognitive interview techniques. We talk about the dangers of producing false confessions, various kinds of confessions, how to prevent false confessions. But what I wanted first and foremost to dive into today was the alternative approach to how to interview suspects. As pointed out here by Roberts and Zuckerman, the fact finder has to follow a mental procedure of progressive elimination of explanations consistent with innocent. Or as pointed out by Allison and Cantor, good thinking is represented by a thorough search for an alternative without favorizing the one already in mind. Now, how do we do that in practical life? How do we teach the detectives to think like that and work like that? Because this is also an effective way. It's now. We tell them that in the planning stage of the interview, you have to, of course, identify all the potential evidence that you may possess. But before the interview starts, you have to identify all other explanations to this potential evidence. Could the person be innocent? Could there be an alternative explanation? He may be innocent. And this is also effective because if he is not innocent, and he has intentions to get away with it, he will come up with an alternative explanation to the evidence pointing towards him. So after having done the detective work, this is the detective work, this is smart thinking. Huh? And then we start the interview, provide him with the opportunity to give his free account, and then we explore all possible explanations without exposing the evidence, and we delay the disclosure. Now, if we look at it, and we try to teach it as a model so that the detectives understand it. Let's say we have a potential evidence here. It could be a fingerprint, it could be DNA, it could be a stray of hair. Let's say it is a stray of hair in the car of a missing girl, and the description fits your car, and you are arrested. Now, if I, without any tactical considerations, go straight into the evidence, like many of us were taught when we were trained detectives. Listen, we have a stray up here in the trunk of your car. Come on, man. You know, a positive and direct confrontation, as FBI calls it, to try to shock the suspect into confessing immediately. Now, if the person is innocent, there is an explanation for that stray up here in the back of your car. If you are guilty, and we do this without consideration, without being smart detectives, then you may say, well, now that you mentioned it, I did pick up a hitchhiker the other day. Anything else you wanted to know? we may lose the evidence. So we have to think differently, as I said, and we have to start to investigate and explore all other possibilities. So I will start by asking, who drives your car? How many keys do you have to the car? Has it been stolen? Have you lent it to somebody else? Have you transported any goods for anybody else? Have you had any passengers, etc., etc.? And we do this, and we are looking for that alternative explanation. Perhaps you did pick up a hitchhiker. So this is how we operationalize the presumption of innocence, and we are stimulating the detectives, their open-mindedness, because they are searching for an alternative explanation. But this is also effective, because if there are no alternative explanation, then it becomes very hard for the guilty suspect, when we do present the potential evidence that we have, to come up with a story that the judge will actually believe, because we have investigated the alternative explanations. So this is how the model, in very short, looks like. And yes, as we say, if you are guilty, then it's also effective. There has been quite a bit now research, but not enough. We need more research in this field. We are just starting it as a scientific field, really. Think about medicine, for instance. I mean, we are just in the start of it. But nevertheless, we have 30 years of research. And in their report of a meta-analysis, Christian Masoner and his colleagues compared interrogation techniques with investigative interviewing. And not only did they find that it reduces false confessions, they found that it actually, as Mendez has pointed out, it increased true confessions because it stimulates communication. Now, the Senate report, you are well aware of, confirms that when we use harsh techniques, the information stops. So it's pointed out here that there are a new movement around the world. England started it, Great Britain started it, Norway followed, New Zealand has certainly committed to investigative interviewing, Canada, Australia, many other countries are looking into it as the model to go. And we clearly believe that it is the way forward, and that we can actually operationalize the presumption of innocence in a sustainable way, in a way that police officers and will understand and find applicable. So just to close up, our argument then is that this way of gathering information, this was our first interviewer at the station of Breivik, she says sitting here, every second is of course recorded, and she's interviewing him, and she's listening to him. She is interested to hear his story, why he did it, how he did it, how he planned to prepare. And he felt that he was respected and that he was listened to. And he talked and talked and talked and talked. And we were then able to prove that he was alone. There was no cell 2 and 3. But you can imagine if we had started to torture him. At a certain point, he must have come up with a few names. We don't know who, but he must have, if the torture was bad enough. Sure, you can make people talk, but to gather accurate and reliable information, this approach by far is shown now by more and more research is superior. So thank you very much for your attention. This is a short introduction to investigative interviewing, and be happy to discuss the way forward and questions.
Okay, we'll come back to the questions later, but there was one question I asked, which is, the resistance, and I need to ask this question because we need a few minutes to get the technical equipment going for Shayla Murrow. Is she gone? Yeah, she's gone. The resistance from police officers, was there initial resistance to this because it's a different way of going about work? And what's the view of Norwegian police officers now to what you've just told us?
Yes. I mean, there were colleagues of ours that didn't really look us into the eyes when we came and said that we have to change. I have brought with me my boss from the Norwegian Police Academy, and as you can see, he is the generation above me. And when he talks about this in Vietnam and in Indonesia, he calls it the painful process of change. So there was. But when we discussed it and when we showed them the techniques and we gave them the training, we would say that almost everybody has come aboard. And there was plenty of police officers that actually embraced it immediately. Not to mention, not least to mention our women, our female detectives, who did not really see that the techniques that we were using to force or manipulate confessions, they didn't fit their way of communicating. And the police academy supported us. The national prosecuting service supported us. And today, this is has been embraced throughout the country. I'm not saying that you will find an interview here and there that are in breach of these principles. I mean, the values behind crime control. In which the confession is, the driving force. The values behind crime control is a constant battle for priority with the values behind the due process. So we cannot lean back in Norway or in the UK and say that, yeah, well, we have changed to investigative interviewing. No, but now we have a model, we have a standard, and we see that our colleagues embrace it. So, yes. There was a painful process of change by some, and particularly so the ones that were regarded as the best interrogators. Let's face it. They found that in England, the British studies, and we found it in Norway. It was the ones that were regarded and the ones that regarded themselves as the best interrogators that felt that when Ivar and I came with this new knowledge, that it felt that who are you guys? I mean, 30 years old. Come on, you know that. But even most of them are now embracing it and realizing that we had to change. One interesting point there, if I may, is that we knew that if there was a public debate about this, we would win. Because our arguments did and would and will stand the test of daylight. Their arguments would not. So we were prepared to meet them in an open public debate. And we also know that our direction has the foundation of scientific backing. So we felt quite confident in going into a public debate if that was necessary, and that sometimes it was.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Mark Kelly is international human rights lawyer with extensive experience of working with the European system of prevention of torture, and also within Ireland and the Irish Council of Civil Liberties. I won't say any more, but I'm very pleased to have Mark with us present today. We'd be very interested to hear about that regional experience and what you take from that and how you feel that these proposals are relevant to the to that work. And you have 7 minutes to do so. Mark, you have the floor.
Okay, thank you very much, Mark. And I very much hope we do get to hear from Shane O'Mara. I had the privilege of listening to his presentation before the meeting, and it's very, very compelling. And essentially what it does is it adds to a significant body of evidence that suggests that torture doesn't work, that it's not effective. But what we are also learning now, and this is, I think, also certainly the experience within the Council of Europe region, the 47 member states of the Council of Europe, is that torture prevention can work in certain circumstances. And I'm very pleased, it's a nice surprise that Richard Carver and Lisa Hanley are here today, sitting very modestly at the back of the room, because in the European Committee for the Prevention of Torture, sitting in plenary session, we again had the privilege of having a preview of their work. And it was quite a disconcerting session, I have to say, because
They came along and their presentation was entitled "Does Torture Prevention Work?" And they were addressing 47 treaty body members who have been spending, in some cases, the best part of a quarter of a century working on the assumption that some of what we were doing does work. So it was somewhat of a relief to find by the end of the session that they were able to make some clear assertions. And in particular, when you look at their work, which I would encourage you to do, and also the Association for the Prevention of Torture have done some very good work condensing it. There's a fact sheet so far, I think, in English, French, and Spanish on your website. I think more languages coming. The message is very clear. And the top thing that they're emphasizing is that effective safeguards in detention can be highly effective. Prosecution of torturers is also quite compelling, as is monitoring, which was the relief for the CPT. I wanted to pick up a little bit before getting into the detention safeguards on the, almost as a bridging point, the potential for this model of investigative interviewing to improve matters. And I'm very convinced by what Asbjørn has to say. At the same time, I would make the point that in common with other detention safeguards, you really, and this is the experience of the CPT, that you have to have in place the means to objectively verify whether or not what you're training police officers to do, whether or not what you have in your codes of practice is actually happening in practice. Because if you don't have that, with the best will in the world, often that's not what's happening. And in your excellent report, Special Rapporteur, you give the example of Northern Ireland as a jurisdiction in which, in the past, the application of other methods actually turned out to be an effective recruiting technique for people who would engage in terrorism. But I wanted to emphasize to you that Northern Ireland is actually also an interesting example of a jurisdiction in which the progressive introduction of additional safeguards, in particular during police questioning, shows a different outcome. When I first went to Northern Ireland with the European Committee for the Prevention of Torture, it was in the early 1990s, so it was before the paramilitary ceasefires. And at that stage, there were a couple of specialist interrogation centres that were operating in Castlereagh, in Belfast, and in Cork Barracks in Armagh. And these were centres in which there were significant allegations of ill treatment of people during police questioning. At the time that the CPT first went there, there was a so-called system of monitoring in place, and it consisted of black and white images from cameras in the interrogation rooms. And these were relayed to a control centre where there was a police officer, but there was no sound on this system, and the images weren't recorded at all. And this system was basically completely and utterly ineffective. And if you took your time to walk casually around the centre, you would find the police officer who was meant to be watching the screens, perhaps reading the sports pages of the newspaper or whatever it might be, because it was the most boring job in the world, and it wasn't an effective system. Under pressure, a sound system was introduced so that the officer could switch and could hear a sound, really, but it was still a police officer listening. When that happened, the number of complaints of abusive conduct and coercive conduct during interviews went down quite steeply. And when subsequently a colour system was introduced and also audio and video recording were introduced, then the figures for complaints went into freefall. Now, I'd like to emphasise also that that doesn't mean, and this is important for a point that I want to finish on because I see my time is running very quickly, that doesn't necessarily mean that the actual amount of ill treatment or alleged ill treatment that was happening in there diminished. It could also mean that the potential for people suspected of terrorist offences who were being interviewed in there to make false or malicious allegations was undermined. And that's a point that the CPT was very keen to emphasize. And that's really the point that I want to finish on, because there's a whole constellation of other safeguards that you go through in your report, Special Rapporteur, Section E from page 16 onwards. These are well known: notification of custody, access to a lawyer, meaningful access to a lawyer, meaningful access to an independent doctor, the right to be given coherent information about your rights, the right to remain silent, and so on. But for each and every one of these, it's not sufficient that they actually be embedded in law. They must also be made operationally meaningful for the police officers who are delivering them, and operationally meaningful for the police managers who are meant to be supervising their conduct. And I'll finish on that for now. It's something we might come back to. Understandably, those of us who've spent significant periods of time in independent monitoring place a big emphasis on that. But actually, the internal monitoring by the police themselves of the conduct of their subordinates is absolutely critical. And the means to make sure that that happens in an effective way are also essential underpinnings if these safeguards are going to be effective in practice. And I think that's 7 minutes.
Thank you very much. I was asking some Bahrain police recently who was helping them reform their practice and procedure, and it was Northern Irish police, and it's coming back to the research study. Apparently, the best practice in the UK now is in Northern Ireland. So, a massive transformation over a couple of decades. Are we okay now for... No? Yeah? Okay, we're going to try again with Shane O'Mara.
Okay, so I'm delighted to be here to talk to you today. I want to talk about two topics that are interrelated. The first is why torture doesn't work as an information gathering tool from humans for what we know about how the brain responds to imposed supervening states of stress. And the second thing I want to talk to you about is how we can take what we know from experimental psychology, clinical psychology, and neuroscience to enhance human information gathering in an ethical, humane, and moral fashion. There is no reliable evidence for the efficacy of torture as an information gathering device in humans. There are many cherry-picked anecdotes, but anecdotes do not constitute evidence. This was apparent to Bonaparte about 200 years ago when he wrote famously in a letter that this method of gathering information did not work because the poor brutes would tell you anything they could in order to make the torture stop. Darius Rejali, the famous historian of torture, has written extensively on the history of torture, both in democracies and in autocracies. And he concludes his masterwork, Torture and Democracy, with a single and very vital claim, and it is this: that those who believe in torture's effectiveness do not leave any reports behind of its efficacy, and they prefer to leave no proof. If torture is the attempt to force information from the unwilling, then by definition, torture is the attempt to force information from the brain systems of the unwilling. This is true by definition. It cannot be any other way. And this is the peculiar place where you have an interaction between government policies about coercion on the one hand and what we know about brain function on the other hand. The brain has a very important job. It supports all of the tissues in our body in order to keep us alive. It is the seat of our mood, our emotion, our cognition, and our motivation. The theory behind torture holds that if we impose a supervening state of stress, this can be sleep deprivation, it can be physical assault, it can be predator threat, it can be hunger, it can be extremes of cold and heat, it can be food and liquid deprivation or whatever, that somehow when you apply these states to another person over a period of time, that this will facilitate the release of information from that person's long-term memory. And we can go to the experimental literature and we can ask, in fact, what the effect of these states, supervening states of stress are on the functioning of the brain. Do they positively impact on it? Do they negatively impact on it? Or do they have a neutral effect? And we can do this across all of the differing states that we've just mentioned, from mood, through cognition, through motivation, through executive functioning. And we have many populations that we can focus on. For example, it is by now well known from many, many studies conducted in combat soldiers that long periods of sleep deprivation combined with caloric restriction, liquid restriction, results in a uniform degradation of psychological state across all its manifestations, from mood to memory, to every aspect of cognition, to decision-making, to retrieval of information from long-term memory. To take a different and important specimen result, air and access to air is necessary for humans and other species to stay alive. And air restriction is a very, very common method of torture, be it by placing a plastic bag over somebody's head or by waterboarding and filling the airways with water, preventing breathing. And we know a lot from the literature on diving and the physiology of diving over the last 100 years about the effects of procedures like this. The first thing we can say with certainty is that air hunger causes activation in parts of the brain that are concerned with fear, anxiety, and immediate survival. And of course, we perceive this to be really unpleasant. Experimentally, if we take humans and we ask them to wear a mask and we reduce the fraction of oxygen that you inhale by 50%, so just a reduction by 50%, and replace that with an inert gas like nitrogen, we can then ask what effect that kind of air hunger has on normal brain function. And what we find uniformly is that it just a reduction in oxygen intake like this over a period of a couple of minutes causes remarkable perceptual distortions. It causes people to feel like they're dizzy. It causes people to feel as if they have headaches. It causes them to feel like they're dissociated and zoned out from the environment. On the central functioning side, though, what happens to cognition and what happens to mood? Well, what you see when you induce experimental hypoxia in volunteers who are motivated to participate because they have volunteered in the first place is a uniform degradation of all aspects of cognition, from simple tests of short-term memory to their ability to engage in simple working memory tasks like addition, all the way through to their ability to recall previously learned information. And the effect is very, very marked in experimental motivated volunteers. Sleep deprivation, I've mentioned already briefly. This is a very, very common technique that's used to extract confessions from people in custody, whether deliberately or inadvertently. And we now know from experimental studies in volunteers that participants will falsely admit to having broken a piece of experimental equipment if they have been sleep deprived, and they will not admit to having done so if they are not sleep deprived. A really, really remarkable and important result. So coming back to the major question, does torture work in the sense of yielding veridical information from memory or from the brain's memory systems? The answer has to be this. The signal-to-noise ratio is astonishingly low and the false positive rate is astonishingly high compared to other methods. And this is why huge numbers of innocents have been convicted on the basis of confessions extracted under torture through the decades and the centuries. Furthermore, experienced interrogators, whether in the field or in custody, all uniformly repudiate torture as useless for veridical information gathering. However, if you want to extract repudiations of beliefs, if you want people to falsely confess to something, well then torture in that narrow sense works. We're then left with the question of what it is that we should do. Interrogation, questioning, self-reporting is something that we engage in all the time. It's a pervasive aspect of our interactions. It happens in everyday life. It happens when we're maybe at border crossings, when we talk to our physician or whatever it happens to be. Police forces throughout the world regrettably rely on provocational or confrontational interviewing, despite the experimental evidence showing that this is a very poor method of getting or extracting veridical information from the person that they are interviewing. What we know when you study humans using language in the field is that about 40% of what we say to each other involves personal revelation or self-disclosure. Moreover, we know also that if we do brain imaging in people who are engaged in self-disclosure, that the brain's reward circuits are activated. In other words, people have a natural propensity to engage in self-disclosure. Human information gathering is a particular problem for the behavioral and brain sciences to solve, and it's one that that they're more than capable of doing. Do we know what works? Well, to a certain extent we do. We know that good, skilled interrogators tend to be older, they tend to be mature, they tend to be exceptionally good at perspective taking. They are able to do something known as active listening. In other words, they try and adopt the position of the person that they are interrogating rather than engaging in a coercive or confrontational fashion. The final thoughts that I want to leave you with are this. Interrogation is far too serious to be left to amateurs. It is a major a problem for the behavioral and brain sciences to solve, and we need to create an experimental social psychology and an experimental cognitive neuroscience of interrogation. Thank you.
Okay, well, and thanks for those of you who made that work. I think that was worth waiting for and listening to. I'd like now to shift to maybe more going back to field experience, and we're fortunate to have with us Gaston Chillieu, who's the executive director of CELS, that's the Centro de Estudios Legales y Sociales from Argentina. And Gaston would like to benefit from your experience working in Argentina and Latin America, where there are ongoing problems of policing. And I'd like to ask, what are some of the main reasons that torture and other ill treatment persist as a tool for investigating common or organized crimes? Gaston, you have the floor.
Thank you. Thank you, Mark. I think I will mention four main reasons because torture is still a main tool for investigation. And I think that the first one is well explained in Professor Mendes' last report, and has to do with the inquisitorial model of criminal investigation that has been used for a long time and is being used in place. As Osborne mentioned, I think in that inquisitorial model, confession is the driving force, and I will say the suspect is the object of the investigation. And I say object on purpose. It's not a person with rights, but is the main object of the investigation. So I think from there with this inquisitorial model, the law enforcement, or I will talk about more than law enforcement, the model of investigation that include the judiciary, the judiciary operators and law enforcement, just think on torture as the only element. I mean, as the whole system. I think this is a systematic, and this is something that I think from Latin American perspective is important to mention, because in many legal systems in Latin America, law enforcement don't interrogate suspects, or don't interrogate in the formal process. They do in a parallel, in an informal process. when they bring the suspect to the judiciary system, the torture has been already applied. So I think that is a main. I mean, the confession is the shortcut for investigation in the criminal investigation model that I think is quite worldwide, not only in Latin America. So from there, the taking in consideration that the lack of training in another alternative model is the second reason. So because confession is the protagonist of the main tool for investigation, there are not other alternative training capacities. We just have seen the neuroscience, like forensic, the gather of evidence that is in place with other alternative measures are not in place. So there is no build on capacity for other kind of investigation. I mean, one way. I mean, if confession is the only tool, there is no need in order to strengthen other capacities to get the truth. I mean, just the only one is the confession. The third reason, I think, and this is all applied to Latin America, I think it has to do with the legacy of authoritarian regimes or armed conflicts, in which, you know, in the 70s in South America or in the 80s in Central America, both, I mean, authoritarian regime or armed conflicts, the model of the public security was a model in which the suspect was treated as an enemy, no, is not as a subject of rights, and I think that has permitted the culture of the investigation, and the fourth reason related with that is and still is a main obstacle for different Latin American judiciary system and law enforcement and policy is the militarization of the law enforcement officials or law enforcement security forces. And actually, most of the security forces in Latin America that are the main auxiliary for the investigation has not been reformed, democratically reformed, and they still are using and are actually shaped by authoritarian culture. And actually, in countries like Mexico, the military forces are conducting investigations and actually not law enforcement as well. So, taking in consideration that, I really think that I really highlight the report of Professor Mendez, because here we are confronting a systemic problem. It's like a structural problem, and the idea of on the one hand, I think as has been said, we already have a lot of evidence of the failure of mistreatment, cruel treatment, torture in order to obtain confession as a model of investigation. And I think this is something, it's not a problem of lack of evidence. But the second part, and I think this is the interesting thing of the report and the idea of discuss guidelines for interrogation protocol is the idea of this interviewing model as a way to make the presumption of innocence operational. And I think the idea of to not only show that the torture or mistreatment is not working, but also trying to show that the operationally using the principle of innocence or human rights standard can be also effective in order to get effective investigation. And this is something that I think is a good starting point in order to promote the debate, not only with security forces, but also in Latin America, with judiciary system, but also with policymakers. And I think the way to combine the principles set of arguments, but also the practical set of values in order to change the paradigm of criminal investigation, I think is very important, and to show the law enforcement official, the judiciary operators, that human rights standards are not obstacles to obtain an effective investigation, but can be vehicles in order to be effective in the criminal investigation. So in that way, I from a NGO human rights perspective, I celebrate the idea of Professor Mendes, and I think it's a great thing as a part of the last report of his mandate to kick off this discussion, and we are ready to engage in the future, and I hope the next special rapporteur will continue.
Thank you very much, Gaston, from that point of view, from the field, if I could put it that way. Let's shift our attention to the challenge of national security and investigations related to that. And we're fortunate to have with us Catherine Hawkins from the Constitution Project, which is a US-based organization working on national security and human rights. Catherine, is it realistic to expect national security intelligence interrogations to follow the same model as law enforcement? And what will have to change in interrogation practices currently practiced by some states in order for such practices to comply with Juan's report and proposals?
Thank you very much. I think that the basic interviewing model should be the same in national security contexts and domestic law enforcement. And a process seeking to gain truth and accurate information rather than forcing a confession. A U.S. organization within the FBI called the High Value Interrogation Group recently released a report on best practices for interrogation, and it's quite consistent with the recommendations of the Special Rapporteur's report. It recommended that interviews be individualized, rapport-based, information-seeking rather than confession-seeking, respecting a detainee's autonomy, and emphasized the importance of allowing a free account and deploying evidence later in the interview, and seeking to enforce to enhance memory. I think that a model that seeks confessions and assumes guilt can actually be especially dangerous in an armed conflict because there's a language barrier, there's a lack of cultural knowledge, there's innocence will inevitably be detained even more so than in a normal police context, and there's a lack of regular judicial process or some of the safeguards. And I mean, I don't think I need to go into the history, but the US experiment with coercive interrogations and torture went very, very badly. Now, some of the specific safeguards that the Special Rapporteur recommends might be logistically more difficult to implement in a combat zone. I think it might be useful to recommend that, for instance, if a full audio, if a video recording isn't possible at certain locations, audio recording is a useful substitute. And if access to counsel is not possible, then accessed by some sort of independent monitor becomes even more important. So I think the ICRC is always ready to offer its services to states whereas providing lawyers in a combat sense might be more difficult. As far as what state practices would need to change, I'm just going to speak to the United States because that's really the system I know. Law enforcement interrogation in the United States, obviously they can't use force or violence. There's a right to silence. There's a right to counsel. But it is common to use, confront a detainee with false evidence. There is, and long interrogations are permitted. And there's false confessions are too common. Recording of interviews is increasing, but it's not universal. U.S. law enforcement is quite decentralized, so there's a lot of variance from department to department. In the national security context, all U.S. national security interrogations are now limited to techniques listed in an Army field manual for interrogation. And that field manual definitely prohibits the worst abuses that we saw immediately after September 11th, but it's flawed and not entirely consistent with the Special Rapporteur's report. I said their particular problem with the field manual is it has a section called Appendix M that Juan Mendez's report mentions, and that describes a technique called separation, and it basically allows for certain detainees who are considered unlawful combatants, there can be renewable 30-day periods of isolation. There's language saying that during the separation technique, detainees must get at least 4 hours of sleep per night, but you know that in effect means only 4 hours per night, renewable indefinitely. And there's permission to use goggles or earmuffs to techniques that are in effect sensory deprivation for renewable 12-hour periods. And the field manual also recommends that this technique is effective in combination with an effort to prolong the shock of capture to efforts to create a sense of futility for the detainee and to increase the detainee's fear. So how that's used in practice isn't actually very clear, both how much it's used and the precise way it's implemented, but that is certainly, you know, quite at odds with the investigative interviewing model. And more generally, the field manual, it's an old document and it talks about individual approaches, and it's very much in line with the confrontational model of getting someone to confess what they know. So that would have to be revised. I think, fortunately, that is, by statute, it's due for revision in a few years. And then one positive practice of the United States is that ICRC access is now required, even in a non-international armed conflict, as a matter of domestic law.
Okay. I would imagine that some of you are interested to hear the response of the two Norwegian police officers to what we just heard there. I don't know if you'd like to react immediately to that, or else we can take that up in questions and answers, but clearly quite a different approach to the one that you described. I can see you. Let me switch back to Mark and Juan, because we're talking here about changing practices, and it's not always a straightforward process of changing a practice of how people go about doing interrogation work. We've seen examples of countries where the constitutions have been rewritten, laws reformed, and even police training provided, yet allegations of torture and severe ill treatment persist. So drawing on your extensive fieldwork experience, what would the two of you say are the major institutional roadblocks that remain to be dismantled in order that we see changes of law, policy, and practice that will translate into different ways in which police go about their work?
Yes, I mean, I think that is the critical question in a way, and it's handled very extensively in your report, Professor Mendez. There's a need, I think, to see questions like police investigation or police interviewing and safeguards in detention in a much bigger context, because these interviews, these truth-finding or confession-inducing processes take place within the architecture of criminal justice systems as a whole. And within the architecture of criminal justice systems, unfortunately, there's also quite frequently what I would call almost an architecture of impunity. And it's not enough, I think, in many countries, obviously, to look just at the constitution or look at law or practice or policy or training in the police detention setting or police questioning. You have to look at the system as a whole. And very often, I think, at least in the CPT's experience, where you find countries in which there have been reform processes, and of course within the Council of Europe space since the early 1990s, this has been the case, that there have been great processes of constitutional reform and so on, but practices are not really changing. You find other problems. You find problems with the independence of judges and lawyers and prosecutors that are impinging on outcomes. You find that it is still very rare, even within the European space, for there to be models of genuine independent oversight. It's still really quite unusual that there are investigators completely independent of the police who are looking at allegations of police misconduct. And I think coupled with that, we're still in a historic moment in which new accountability mechanisms, for example, the national preventive mechanisms under the optional protocol to the UN Convention Against Torture, are relatively immature, and many of them are yet to become fully effective. And the same, unfortunately, can be said of national human rights institutions in a number of countries, where you have institutions that, formally speaking, are compliant with the Paris principles, that look fantastic on paper, but in practice are not necessarily doing their job in a proactive way, particularly where sensitive issues like this are concerned. But I mean, the very top thing for me, actually, and this is more from practical experience of really having looked at this in great detail for the CPT, is that in very many countries, the way in which an allegation of ill treatment by a law enforcement official will be looked at is completely different from the way in which an allegation of physical assault by an ordinary member of the public will be looked at. And when you actually go, and this is the advantage that the CPT has, that we are able to go to prosecutors' offices, we're able to look at prosecutors' files, we're able to look at material that otherwise would be sub judice. And unfortunately, very often what you find is that a file that is an investigation of an allegation of a very serious assault, in fact, doesn't contain the material that you would expect it to contain. It doesn't contain the forensic material, that interviews haven't been done expeditiously, DNA hasn't been sought within reasonable time limits. And if you do an exercise of comparing that with how the very same prosecutor or the very same police department has investigated an allegation of a fight on a Saturday night outside a nightclub, you find a completely different situation. And making that breakthrough to ensure that the system as a whole will treat the investigation of allegations of torture or severe ill treatment by law enforcement officials with the same thoroughness and the same seriousness as they treat the investigation of ordinary criminality, between inverted commas, I think is an absolutely essential thing to achieve.
Okay. No double standards and the coherence in the methodology. Juan?
Yes, thank you. Well, I think the examples given by Ms. Hawkins show that it's important that if we do work towards a document, a protocol, or a set of guidelines, it has to apply to all forms of investigations and all forms of interviews in investigations, including extraterritorial aspects of state agents operating outside the borders. Just like in the standard minimum rules, the Nelson Mandela rules, we insisted that it applies to detention not only in serving time, but in pretrial detention, in juvenile detention, and even in military detention everywhere. Because otherwise we're going to have a big gap in protection. And I also think it's important to focus on physical mistreatment, but also on mistreatment of a mental sort. I think if you're going to use separation, or whatever you call it, it's really solitary confinement for relatively long periods. 30 days renewable is a very long period. It's prolonged. And you do it in the context of preventive detention and in the course of investigations, that is a form of coercion that that we should close the gap on that as well. I was just reminded that recently in Japan they reopened a case of a confession, and a woman had served like 20 years for killing her child, and it turns out that she was not guilty, and she confessed because she had been held in solitary confinement like for a very prolonged period, months at a time, and in order to break out from that isolation, she pleaded guilty to this crime. And I read in that context that solitary confinement in pretrial detention during the investigative process is a very pervasive technique in places like Japan. And we need to cover that aspect as well. And not only in our experts' meetings, where we had several really very interesting, very brilliant armed forces investigators from the United States that shared their experience with us, but only a couple of weeks ago, I attended a conference in the Kennedy School of Government in Harvard, where some other investigators from the armed forces explained what went wrong in places like Bagram and Abu Ghraib. And a couple of things that I think need to be considered for, because we have to be self-conscious that this is a change of culture that needs to happen. One is that is training, which we've heard already has to happen. Asbjorn made a point on that. In Iraq and in Afghanistan, the U.S. Armed Forces recruited at the most basic entry level people who were going to be interrogated and did not provide them with any training until later when they had to reform that. And second, leadership. You know, not only the officers making themselves responsible for supervision and command control, but also not delegating this. And in the early stages of Iraq and Afghanistan, the U.S. Armed Forces delegated interrogation to entry-level people without training, and delegated their supervision to very low-level people in the chain of command. And so, if we're going to have a serious cultural change, we're going to need to focus on leadership and on training. But first, we need to have a set of standards, a gold standard that we can compare, and that hopefully will include again issues of training and leadership, as well as practical techniques. And particularly based on the presumption of innocence and the pursuit of truth.
Okay. If I could ask a second question to Gaston and Catherine about this problem of persons who commit the crime of torture and ill treatment, and that if there are those persons are not being properly investigated and sanctioned, what do you think are the remedies to change that and to ensure that we don't have impunity?
Okay. I think there have been a few problems in the United States ensuring impunity. I think two of the central ones have been that the agencies responsible for torture had the ability to classify the evidence and ensure that the evidence remained secret, and the fact that the Justice Department responsible for criminal investigations is also the Justice Department that authorized the techniques. Those were the two central problems. I think one thing that's important is the United States has been asked about this repeatedly, and it's cited an investigation that it did conduct by an independent prosecutor, a U.S. attorney for the Justice Department named John Durham. And it recommended no charges, but we don't know why, and no files from that investigation have ever been made public. And I think the explanation, the sort of legal justification for not charging anyone, is important to know for fighting impunity. I think another thing that is important is ensuring that there's access to justice in civil courts, because a victim can bring a suit in civil court. They can't force the prosecutor to prosecute. And so it's not a substitute for criminal accountability, but it is an important supplement, and limits on secrecy there can also make a big difference.
First of all, I think the level of impunity in case of tortures in probably most of Latin American countries is so high, it's almost is very, very high, and that is one of the main reasons of, because the practice keep being repeating itself. I mean, there is one of the obligation of international law for non-recurrence is just to have a effective investigations and prosecution and punishment of these practices. But the second main reason is, as I said before, as the problem is systemic, that includes all the judiciary system and the judicial operators use the security forces on law enforcement in order to investigate the common crime or organized crime or other type of criminal activities, then they are very reticent, and they don't want to investigate them when the security forces apply tortures in order to get confession. So, the judiciary, the prosecutors know and that this confessional approach is used, and as we have been saying, is the principal method of investigation. So there is no way to question the system. I mean, this is the second main problem, and also is structural. And the third, I think, in a good practices at least in my country, in Argentina and others, has been in order to broke this impunity barrier, the role of the victims of torture has been critical in the process as private prosecutors in criminal or also the promotion of civil remedies. And this is has the role of the victims has shown that an effective method. Overall, I think the main obstacle is the systemic problem that avoid effective investigation for these practices.
Okay. Thank you, Gaston. Last question for Asbjorn. One solution would appear to be, let's monitor more what happens in interrogation and let's have transparency, etc. But from a policing point of view, I understand that there is a certain integrity to the interview process, which is important to protect as well. So how do we get that balance right of monitoring and investigative interviewing, and what would your views be on that from a police perspective?
Yeah, well, thank you very much. And at the same time, Norway introduced investigative interviewing techniques and training in those techniques. We also introduced a video recording of our interviews. And we remember some of our colleagues were skeptical, because we need that intimacy, et cetera, et cetera. But what I can say, and this is documented from research from all over in countries that has introduced video recording or audio recording, is that once police officers has actually enjoyed the security it is to preserve evidence and gather evidence, they don't want to go back to the old way of doing it. And particularly so when they testify and provide evidence in court, they can stand there and they are not receiving allegations of pressures, et cetera. So the experience, despite the skepticism from some that it will destroy the communication, etc., has proven to be false. They don't want to go back to the old system, as we call it now, without recordings.
Okay. We are meant to finish by 12 o'clock, and we still got some concluding remarks come from Ambassador of the UK. But just before I hand the floor to Ambassador Shearman, would anybody else like to raise any questions to the panelists, make any comments as well? You're welcome to do so. So we have two people here. If you could just introduce yourself as well. And we have somebody down the right-hand side. Okay. If you don't mind, if we could just limit to three interventions. Okay?
Hello. Thank you very much. My name is Anastasia Ovsyanniko. I'm a Moscow-based researcher assistant for Human Rights Watch. So I wanted to ask about any research on the effects that the execution of torture has on the executioner, because I think that's another point on how we can actually promote the concept of investigative interviewer instead of the interrogation, because I'm sure there is some negative effect on the people who execute the torture, and that can be another point. So thank you very much.
Okay, maybe Asbjorn, you could also respond to that as well.
Let's take the three questions.
Yeah, that's okay. We have this. Can we have the second question?
My name is Eva Fass. Can you hear me? Eva Fassing from the Norwegian Police University College. I think I just wanted to place a comment on the question that whether these recommendations or standards should be applicable to all kinds of investigative interviewings, regardless of context. And I think if you bring this over to intelligence and warfare and things like that, it's probably even more crucial that you don't go into tunnel vision, because this is about prevention and about how you're planning your operations. So what we have seen when we train intelligence officers both in Norway but also in Indonesia, exactly the same theory applies. So, but I have to underline, I think there are really, really interesting developments in the US, and it's not very recent either. I recommend to read the book of Ali Safan and how he conducted interviews during the war on terror. Interestingly, the book is called Black Banners, because CIA put in so many black banners and he just left them in the book. Really, really good book, and it shows the way that this is operational doable even in critical situations. So just thank you for a very interesting discussion.
Third, and we have one last, but we have to stop there. Yes?
panel. Can you hear me? I want to thank Professor Mendes for his 6-year tenure as Special Rapporteur and all the work that he's done, the great work he's done. My question is about impunity in this last part of the conversation. And I think the question is, I guess for whoever wants to answer it, both thinking about the U.S. context and the Latin American context, a comment that Professor Mendes made about the need for the change in culture, including training and leadership, and then as you link that to impunity, if you were working to end impunity, would you think that the focus would be more important on those who are committing the torture, maybe lower level people who had not been trained, or is there more of a need to focus on looking at chain of command and those who are have the plans and maybe putting together these army field manuals and whatever else documents are out there that are allowing for the procedures to continue? If you had to pick, I mean, obviously, in a perfect world, we'd go after everybody, but in terms of kind of starting cracking at impunity, where would you focus? Thank you.
Where to prioritize. Thank you. And last question or comment?
Human rights. When I'm listening to the presentation and seeing the technique that we're trying to adopt here and discuss, it's I can't help myself but thinking that this is very similar to the way physicians are trained in medicine. And as you think about operationalizing this, I think there are a lot of lessons that could be learned, because the way we teach medical students all over the world is to basically interview the patient about the symptoms they have, gather the evidence, and write down all the plausible diagnoses they have, and then discuss that and eliminate all of those who are not plausible and go with what they have. It's very similar, and it's striking to me that other fields are discussing this kind of approach right now. So I think if we think about operationalizing this, if we're thinking about low-income countries, there are a lot of similarities that could be applied here. But also, if I think about this further now with like the mHealth and all sorts of apps and mobile technologies and things like that, then I'm thinking that this approach could also be, the implementation of this approach could be also accelerated with the use of technology, just drawing on the parallel systems that are in place right now. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much for a very valid point. What I'd like to do now is ask the panelists how they'd like to respond, if any would like to respond to any of the comments that have been raised, but also the other issues that have come up today, for your final take on the matter, and then we'll close the meeting with Ambassador Sherman's concluding comments. So, Juan.
I will only comment on the first question about the effect on torturers. I think that's a very valid point. I don't have any evidence, anecdotal or otherwise, about what happens to someone who is asked to do this kind of deadly and terrible thing to others. But I do think, and Gaston will probably confirm, that the effect on the institutions that torture is incredibly offensive. I mean, especially combined with the impunity that Viviana was talking about, what happens in Latin America, at least, is that now that we have democratic regimes and that we have a vibrant open society and the victims speak out and all that, we still cannot depend on the police forces to protect us, to defend us. We don't trust them. We don't give them the support that they need to solve crime because they are involved in this culture of torture. So at least from the institutional perspective, I don't have any doubt that the effect of letting institutions use torture and get away with it harms not only the society, but it harms the institution itself. It cannot really perform its task well. The other comments are all very well taken, but I won't take more time. Thanks.
Okay. Mark?
Just very brief. Just very briefly and directly to add to that. I mean, I think Shane O'Mara in his presentation was alluding to some of the psychological impact on torturers, and it is a very important point. Unfortunately, practically, the impact on the life of torturers in too many countries is that they get promoted and that they rise through the ranks and they become more prominent and people who report to them see this. So I think it's a very important question, and I realize it's not the sense in which you were asking it, but I do think that we need to move to a situation in which we're looking not just at the disincentives to torturers, but also looking at a framework for positive incentives in which human rights compliant behavior is much more directly rewarded. And that is seen to be the route to the top in police services rather than behaving otherwise.
Thank you. Asbjorn?
Yeah, for me it's very short, and your point that you recognize the way of thinking, it's smart thinking. The thing is that in order to implement that in law enforcement agencies and military, I think it's absolutely crucial that the agencies and the state recognize the need to make the bridge between academia and their police and security forces is crucial. We have seen that when we started to really cooperate with universities and scientists, that's when good things started to happen, as it started in England and it's transforming. So the cooperation between the police and academia is probably one of the bigger picture here, that we can develop best practices through scientific knowledge. Your comments are... is right. Thank you.
And even more academia, the medical world. No? I think we understood that from today. Thank you. So, Catherine, any final comments?
Yeah, I wanted to respond. I think this goes to both the question about the effects of torturers and on impunity. I wanted to read a few quotes from Torture and Democracy that have always been striking on the organizational culture. This is the book by Darius Rajali that... Shane mentioned it in his presentation. To think professionalism as a guard against causing excessive pain is an illusion. Instead, torture breaks down professionalism. Professionals become less disciplined, more brutal, and less skilled, while their organizations become more fragmented and corrupt. First, torturers go beyond the specified suspects to torture individuals not normally tortured. Second, torturers go beyond the approved techniques to a broader range of brutalities. Third, torturers break away from bureaucratic oversight. I think we've seen all of those in practice in the United States after September 11th. And it's a slow process, sort of putting the genie away again.
Thank you.
Very brief regarding Viviana's question about if we are talking about a problem that is a cultural problem, is a systemic problem, of course, I think we have to prioritize the leadership level and not the lower ranks. And I totally agree with Juan's comment about the effect of torture in the institutions. We are still dealing with the legacy of these practices. And so we need a strong leadership in order to make this cultural change effective. Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Gaston. So I'd now like to hand the floor over to Martin Schirman, who's the Ambassador for Human Rights, Development and Peacebuilding at the UK Mission here at the UN. Martin, you have the floor.
Great. Thank you very much, Mark, and thank you, Professor Mendes, and all of the other speakers. I was really pleased that we as the UK were sponsoring this event, and having listened to the 2 hours of really fascinating discussion, I'm even more delighted that we were able to help make it happen. A few reflections. I mean, we shouldn't need to win the argument that the use of torture is unacceptable. But if we do need to win that argument, I think listening to the speakers today has reinforced the fact that it's not just, you know, the case for respecting rights is absolute, but it's also about operational effectiveness. Or as Professor O'Mara said, bringing the science, ethics, and policy into line. It's an incredibly powerful case. And to be honest, if I have a regret today, it's that we don't have a wider audience for this discussion, because I think it would be a huge benefit, particularly in a context where rights are sometimes contested on the basis that they may be a good thing, but they get in the way of, you know, the things we need to achieve in the short term. This is just such a powerful discussion, showing the, you know, the strength of the case for the abolition of the use of torture, including in police and investigative settings. In the interest of full disclosure, I have to say that we as the UK, as the government, haven't yet sort of taken a position on Professor Mendes's proposal for a protocol in this area. But we're studying it closely, and the discussion today is really helpful in that context. I have, however, been struck again in this discussion by the importance of the international angle here. Now, obviously, national standards, the enforcement of national standards, domestic lobbies for change, the political context within individual countries is vital and in a way the key to sustainable change. But again, it's fascinating to hear of the importance of cooperation between police forces, what we heard about Norway working in Indonesia and Vietnam, and also some references to the work that the UK and the, in particular, the police in Northern Ireland have done in this area. So that international cooperation, I think, amongst practitioners in the interest of raising standards is also incredibly important. I would also like just to draw attention to the importance of continued political engagement around these issues, and perhaps a bigger and renewed campaign around signature and ratification of the optional protocol, the Convention Against Torture. Mr. Kelly said something about monitoring, both independent monitoring, but then also internal monitoring by the police themselves. So I think, again, that points to the importance of the optional protocol. And certainly we as the UK, first of all, we'd like to feel that confident that we have procedures in place that are satisfactory for our own officials, though, of course, we're always open to challenge on that. But this question of how we raise standards around the world and the role of monitoring, I think, is absolutely key. So I suppose one other thing I'd like to take away from this discussion is that for all of us who believe in this, we really need a renewed campaign around the optional protocol. In closing, could I just say on behalf of the UK government, our thanks to Professor Mendes for all the work he's done as a special rapporteur, which has been sterling work and for which we're very grateful. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Martin. Now, of course, I would like to stay here all afternoon to carry on this discussion, but I have to respect the fact that you all have other important things to move on to. So, unfortunately, I do have to close the meeting now. Those of you who would like to stay on, the room is still available if you'd like to talk with Juan and other panelists about the important next steps. You know, and I think it's very important to keep this interest in this area alive. At the APT, we will certainly be finding ways to bring carry on this process and bringing people together to ensure that we do make progress. We have the evidence now. We have today heard also, as you rightly say, Martin, compelling evidence that this is the right way forward. Next week I'll be with Asbjorn talking to Pacific Island states about reforming their police practice. So there are ways in which we can all collaborate to ensure that this is going beyond the rooms of the UN here in New York and actually being applied in the field. And I really encourage all of you to stay in contact and to find ways in which we can cooperate together. But I now need to close the meeting. And of course, at this moment, I should also thank all the various panelists. Thank you very much for being with us and making the effort to share with us your experiences and views on this. The organizers, as Washington College of Law, have done an excellent job. I felt very sorry for you regarding the technical challenge, but you succeeded in the end, so well done. And, of course, the sponsors, which include the embassies of Denmark, Norway, UK, and the Office High Commission for Human Rights. So thank you all very much for making it happen. I think we've had an excellent insight into ways in which we can work on this in a way that I'm convinced will make a real difference to the way in which people are treated when they're arrested and interviewed regarding particular cases, etc. So I think we're on the right track, and very much looking forward to working with all of you sometime in the near future and others in the later future. But I think Juan, we've all known now that Juan is retiring very soon as the Special Rapporteur. But I think you'll all agree with me that we have to find ways to ensure that Juan continues working with us to ensure that we see the light of day for the guidelines protocol in this area to make it a world reality. So on behalf of all of us, again, thank you very much, Juan, for your work as Special Rapporteur, and we look forward to collaborating with you in the future.